Everlasting God, creator of all things, who is the light. On this day, we ask that your blessing be with us throughout this Advent season, and we ask you to bless and to sanctify these sources of light, and to hear our prayers as you did hear the earnest prayers of your people throughout the ages. We ask that these candles be to us a symbol of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who is the true light. Grant that as these flames will glow brightly before us, changing darkness to light, that we too may possess the same light of Christ within our hearts that will shine before all people. This we ask through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. May the blessings of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon this Advent wreath. And at this time, if you could light that, we'll call Allison Custard forward. If you want to step up there, it might be a little bit easier.
However, remind us that the light of the world is coming into our lives soon, offering us hope in a darkened world.
Thank you very much, Adam. Girls, all set. These Christmas wafers will be available after Mass, and we do ask just for a small monetary donation to cover the cost that the church has incurred in purchasing these. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined to you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we receive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth. By following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Well, I welcome you here on this first day of a brand new liturgical year, the first Sunday of Advent. It makes perfect sense as we prepare for the coming of Jesus at Christmas. It makes sense that this would be the beginning of the church year that celebrates the whole life of Jesus. We've lit one candle with the Advent wreath, and that's that whole idea that we have increasing light until the coming of Jesus, and on Christmas night we'll have that Christ candle, we'll light the Christ candle, and then we take his light and we spread that through the gathered congregation, and it all begins with that lone, solitary candle right there, and that little light becomes the light that will fill this church on Christmas Eve. So each of these four Sundays represents about 1,000 years. There's this tradition, a random number, but it's 4,000 years between the time of Adam and Jesus. And it's that idea that the world waited for the coming of the Savior. And that's exactly what we do now for four Sundays. We wait the coming of the Savior. So the church is rather stark looking compared probably to a lot of your homes, a lot of the stores, a lot of the streets and everything else. They're already rare to go for Christmas, but the church prepares in this way. To let us concentrate on the fact that we need to prepare ourselves spiritually so when Jesus actually comes, that's when the lights and the festivity and the song and everything erupts in church. And so on this first Sunday of Advent, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And then we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Faithful, who have lived and suffered and died for the Gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that of purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, promised to return to us in the fullness of time. As we hear his word, prepare us for his coming. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed for the church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah. The word that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In the days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be courageous, be strong. Alleluia, alleluia. God rules over the nation, God sits upon his holy throne. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me, so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all of these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. But of that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone. For as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be at the coming back of the Son of Man." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
The child who was completely weak and dependent upon other people, the child who didn't even have a home to be born in, that child right there is the one we are celebrating now. That is the candle of hope. That child is our light of hope. And you would think that, especially that overlap with the readings from last week's "Be prepared or else," and then this child of hope, that you're almost talking about two completely different people. A God who comes with so much power and majesty that we're so awed that we just simply bow down and we tremble. And then we have this example of how Jesus really did come into our world. And so the overlap in the readings is trying to tell us that be prepared or else, and this child of hope, they are really not all that different. They're not as different as we think and imagine. And that's that message again of the overlap in the readings. We don't have a God who's a schizophrenic. The God that was revealed here is the God who's going to come back. The God who's revealed here is the same God that we pray to every single day. It is the God that we invoke here to come to our altar. So Advent embraces the split theme of the coming of Christ as a baby and the coming of Christ as Savior, and tells us it's all the same story. It's all the same Jesus. You know, last Sunday, all of those predictions we talked about, we're not really good at predictions, and I think it's to the point where we have to admit that God has not determined the future because he allows us to have that gift of choice, so future predictions don't really work all that well. But his life was real, and we have stories about his life, and you know those stories about his life, and this is the beginning of that story, and that can't be denied. The predictions we can wonder about, but this we cannot deny. There was a real Jesus, and he walked around with sandals. He was a carpenter. He lived in Galilee in a defeated nation, and he died a horrible death on the cross, and when they stuck that last spear in him, he still said, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." And it all begins with that child of hope. So Jesus, there's this neat little package in the Gospels. Three times he tries to tell his disciples, his closest followers, he's trying to help them in their transition from the Jesus of earth, the Jesus of sandals, to the Jesus of halos up in heaven. And he's trying to get them to understand who he is going to be. So three times he says, "I'm going to die, but I'm going to come back." The first attempt, he says to them, "I'm going to die and I'm going to come back." And you may remember the story because it's just so profound that it sticks in our imaginations. He says that, Peter pulls Jesus to the side and says, "Jesus, that's wrong. It can't be like that." And Jesus says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." The second attempt, he says, "I'm going to die and go to heaven." He's trying to transition the apostles the second time. Now, all of a sudden, the apostles are walking behind him. Jesus is up, maybe contemplative, walking towards Jerusalem. When they get to their destination, they reassemble, and Jesus says, "What were you talking about on the way here?" And not one of them will say anything. And Jesus reprimands them because he knows that they are talking about who is the greatest among them. Number two, they just can't get their idea of who Jesus is. They're still thinking about greatness and honor and privilege. He's got one last attempt, the third attempt. And now, two of his leading disciples, James and John, they come up to Jesus, and in secret they say, "Jesus, when you get to your kingdom up in heaven, give us positions, one at your right and one at your left. Let everybody else bow before us too. When the other 10 find out about the two, the whole bunch of them are all disgusted." And three times Jesus tried to tell them. Three times he tried to transition them from the earthly Jesus of sandals to the heavenly Jesus of halos, and three times they just messed up royally. Now the Gospels are not going out of their way to try and make the disciples look bad. And so with the repeated theme stated three times in three Gospels, is trying to tell us is that this is simply the way it was. The first followers of Jesus simply could not wrap their minds and imaginations around the idea that their God of glory and power and majesty was going to be this revelation of hope. You know, and we're no different 2,000 years later. When we think about God, we use titles like King and Master and all of that. We think of him sitting enthroned up in heaven, and we're going through this miserable life down here just trying to survive. And Jesus has told us three times in the gospel, and he's told us for 2,000 years, "This is who I am." And somehow we insist on making God into such a regal, powerful, far distant creature that he doesn't anymore come to us as hope. He's so distant, he's so other, that we can't grab onto him anymore. We can't pray to him, we can't invoke him. So I think we need to begin to consider again, in this brand new season of Advent, this brand new liturgical year, this idea of overlap. That the Jesus who comes to us at Christmas in four Sundays' time is the exact same Jesus who will come back to us. You know, the Jesus that is now in heaven is the Jesus that walked on earth. This wasn't some kind of grand act by a superb actor. Jesus didn't come down and say, well, I'll do this for 33 years, and then I'll go back up into heaven and be the God that I was always supposed to be. That makes God's revelation a lie. That makes Jesus a lie. And that we simply cannot accept. So if you want to know who God is, this is God. This is his living revelation to us. This child who comes to us as hope. This child who comes to us as one of us. And that's the glory and the power of Advent. Not the glory and power of a sword and a God that is so frightened that we're terrified of him. The glory of Advent is the humbleness of the child. So Advent, as I mentioned, is the beginning of a liturgical cycle. And the other word for cycle is revolution. You know, the earth revolves around the sun. And, well, if you know your old-time, you know, church person in the Middle Ages, the sun revolves around the earth. But we got that wrong, so we had to change it because of the science. But anyway, they're revolving around. That revolution is that same idea of cycle. But revolution also has that power, that idea that it's not just cycling back to the same place over and over and over again. Revolution means change. And so it's kind of like the wheel. The wheel on a bike, you know, moves forward. It goes around in that cycle, but it's taking you forward. It's taking you somewhere. And so revolution, the cycle that is completed and begins again, that is supposed to be about change. It is supposed to be about going closer to God. And that is sometimes something that we forget. We always think of God as in the past. But God is taking us somewhere in the future, and that forward motion all begins today on Advent 1. And it all has to do with the absolutely hard, difficult theology of understanding that this is not only God when he gives up everything and comes into our world, the idea of a God of compassion, the idea of a God who comes in poverty, the idea of a God whose ideal is self-sacrifice, that's not only Jesus. That is the God we now worship up in heaven. And that is absolutely revolutionary. Our God does not have to be a God of richness and power and wealth and everything else that we assume that, you know, God should be. Our God is right there. And when you have an idea of that as God, not only in Christmas, but the God who is now up in heaven, that is absolutely revolutionary. The first Christmas took us by surprise. No one ever thought that God would come this way. But that is who God is. And I think you may be surprised again. And I think it may be worth our while to reimagine our expectations of a kingly Savior. He is the exact opposite revelation of a kingly Savior. And he lived for 3 years. Our predictions don't work so well, but he lived for 3 years. And I talked for 3 years about what it meant to be the Savior. So instead, this Advent season, as we have 4 weeks, just separate just a little bit of that shopping time away. Just separate a little bit of the decorating and the partying time, because that will all come. But just take a little bit of this Advent 4 Sunday season long. And think about the fact that ours is a simple, humble God of hope. Try to get closer to that God. Try to be more like that God. And then Christmas will be so much more meaningful to all of us here. And these are the things we pray on this first Sunday of the new year, this first Sunday of Advent. In Jesus' name, amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this, the first Sunday of a brand new year, we pray that we may increase in our devotion and our love towards you. We may also increase in our commitment to you. We also, at this time, are remembering Winthrop Doty Jr. With prayers, who passed away 34 years ago this month. We also offer our prayers and positive thoughts. Oh, I see what that one is. Okay, I got you. We also offer our prayers at this time still for Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of 3 with stage 4 breast cancer, and Liz Bridgman, diagnosed with cancer and raising 3 young girls on her own, is offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer our prayers
for Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Strauss, Brandy Clements by her grandmother Dottie Baronis, Fathers Ray Trader and Maurice Lizelle is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. And two-year-old Jack Seela is offered by Marianna Foster. And Frank Sprosky is offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families.
Are there any intentions you'd like to offer from the congregation? Yes, Teresa. Very nice. We'll offer that prayer, and I'll be going down tomorrow. Any other prayers?
For Scott Hurley, who passed away unexpectedly last Tuesday from side effects from leukemia. Also for his father, whose actually anniversary of his death will be this week, for Gary Hurley, the 7th anniversary already. So
Scott Hurley is the one we prayed for last week, and he passed away on Tuesday.
He had a stroke on Sunday.
Any other prayers?
For all these intentions, Lord, but plus the private ones that we bring before you in our own thoughts, we ask you to hear all of them. We ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered, Lord, and to be with those who are perished or are unable to be with us here today, those who are traveling today, and also those who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, who is the Lord Jesus Christ. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, the same faith entrusted to the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior, when he said to them, I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. Lord God, you have given us great dignity and glory. Jesus Christ himself, you have sanctified us.
Amen.
brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Merciful Father, you taught us in your holy word that the night is exhausted and the day is quickly approaching. May we, who offer this oblation of the Mass, awaken to live as children of that day and of your life. We ask through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Sending of Jesus Christ to earth for us, you revealed your goodness and unending love. Sharing the hope of patriarchs and prophets, may we worthy prepare a dwelling place for the coming Messiah in our hearts. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide it throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servants and handmaidens. And of all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, unite in spirit with all of those, we give the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who live, labor, and suffer for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believe, profess, and united with you through prayer in this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding within a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he shall live forever, and the bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who he loved in a singular way, and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us,
that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one, as we are one, I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriestly prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner after supper, taking his excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting light. And to those who are in life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
present, and future, and by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our day, supported by the help of your mercy, that we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant her peace and unity of your kingdom. For you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be caused for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may it become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master awakened me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in the unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take a chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Body and the blood of Christ.
Be watchful, be alert, for you never know the time when he will come. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, we give thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus, who comes to us in this heavenly mystery of the Mass, and also in the wonder of his incarnation. Hasten the day when he will come again as our judge and savior. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Pleasing to you, most holy Trinity, grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.